again, running a little bit late. The weather very briefly today. It'll be a wet start for most of us, drying, warming by midday. Good temperatures in the main for most of us through the afternoon, and a little bit wet again tonight.
Coming up, Pat Booth and the magnificent Slimmer of the Year, but right now it's time to rush over to the newsroom where we'll meet Gordon Honeycomb. Gordon.
Hello, good morning. The headlines from TVAM. Investigations are underway in Pakistan into yesterday's air disaster in which the country's president, Zia-ul-Haq, was killed. Five of his generals and the American ambassador to Pakistan also died. The United States says it will help investigate the disaster. President Zia's plane exploded shortly after it took off from Bahawalpur, south of Islamabad. Ishak Khan, the acting president of Pakistan, said that sabotage couldn't be ruled out. General Zia-ul-Haq ruled Pakistan for 11 years. He seized power in 1977 after a military coup. There's a state of emergency this morning in the country as the cabinet meet to discuss the situation. In Beirut, a news agency has been told that Terry Waite is alive and could be released soon if the British government shows some goodwill. The claim was made by a man who said he represented the Islamic Jihad group, but there's been no confirmation that the report is genuine. In Holland, two German bank robbers who were holding 21 passengers hostage on a bus that set out from Bremen have escaped in the town of Oldenzaal with one of the passengers as hostage. Two others were wounded when the gunman fired two shots, but the other 18 passengers escaped uninjured. Earlier, the bank robbers shot dead a 15-year-old boy. Police in Oxfordshire are investigating an incident in which three people were shot dead last night at a house in the village of West Lockinge near Wantage. It's thought the shootings happened when a man found his former girlfriend at the house with a new boyfriend. Police say they're not looking for anyone else in connection with the shootings. In the United States, George Bush has finally romped home as the Republican Party's nominee for president. In a nearby hotel, he and his family watched the conclusive vote at the Republican convention in New Orleans. Finally, children at London's Great Ormond Street Hospital have had an unusual treat, a visit from the Moscow State Circus. The acrobats and jugglers prove that it isn't just a bottle of medicine that can help children along the road to recovery. That's the news. It's 8:34. Richard.
Gordon, thank you. Can I just tell you, if you've just joined us and you're waiting especially for Timmy Mallett at 10 to 9 today, what's on the agenda for Timmy and the team today? Timmy's back off to Switzerland, rather. We've seen some lovely pictures this week, haven't we, from Muesli Mallett, his cousin, showing us around Switzerland at various times. And the cartoon today, again, of course, the favourite, Galaxy High School. All that with Timmy, plus the Mallett and Madness and Mayhem at 10 to 9 today. Now then, just over a year ago, our next guest weighed in at a lumbering 18 stones and 11 pounds. When she was at work, 23-year-old Kay McLennan couldn't resist snacking on cakes, pastries and chocolates.
Then it was home to a four-course special of rich meat stews, stodgy puddings and even more sweets and crisps. But when king-size Kay almost broke the proverbial camel's back while holidaying in Tenerife, she was shamed into doing something about her weight.
King-size Kay. Well, within 13 months, Kay had managed to shed 8 stone to reach her target weight of 9 stone, 13. And yesterday, she was voted Slimming Magazine's Slimmer of the Year. Kay, many, many congratulations.
Thank you.
Good morning to you. King-size Kay, you were a size, weren't you?
Yes.
18 stone. Tell us a little bit more about the turning point in your life, when it was you decided to start losing some of that weight.
Well, it really was the holiday. As you can see, the photograph, when I saw that, it was, as I say, the straw that broke the donkey's back instead of me. But, you know, you had to laugh at the time. I mean, I can joke about it now, but I joked about it then as well, which I think an awful lot of overweight people do. They don't like to admit that they're unhappy, so they smile, and it's a sort of a front that they put up.
And were you genuinely unhappy? Had you been a tubby, for instance, for most of the time that you could remember previously?
Yeah, well, when I sort of started putting on weight when I was about 4, and just sort of inflated gradually over the years, so pretty unhappy, yeah.
But it's something of a generalisation, isn't it? Because I know a lot of people who would claim to be a few pounds, maybe a few stone overweight, or admit that they are, but they're very happy people too.
Yeah, but I think whether it's 8 stones or a stone, everybody's got their own sort of ideal weight that they would like to be. And I think until you're sort of satisfied with that yourself, you sort of tend to sort of sort of be cheery about it and say, oh, no, I'm quite happy, you know. Which I know, as I say, I did, and this is what a lot of people say now, that you were always smiling and you were always joking. But inside, and it's usually when you're on your own, sort of at night when you've left everybody and you go back home and you maybe mull over some of the things you've heard people saying behind your backs, you know.
And especially, I would imagine, through school, because that can be a very hurtful time, can't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, well, children can be very cruel, you know. I think school kids especially can be really cruel, so it was some nasty.
It's what's called the old comfort eating, isn't it, when you get depressed?
That's right. Well, it's a vicious circle, I think. You're depressed because of your size. So you think, oh, I'm unhappy, I'll have a cake or whatever. And then you think, oh, I shouldn't have eaten that. I'm going to get bigger, so you get depressed and eat again.
Okay, you were 18 stone, and you really look fabulous now. Would you mind standing up and just showing the viewers just how well you've done? You're slim, tall, and elegant.
Give us a 12, Kay.
Give us a 12.
Let's go for it. That's it. Oh, that's
marvellous.
Just to probe a little bit further, a bit naughty of me, I know, but I notice you're engaged.
Yes.
The man in your life, is it the same man that you were engaged to when you carried all that weight?
Yes, well, I met him when I'd lost 2 stones, but that was a hard point as well. It was 4 stones before anybody actually noticed that I was losing weight.
Cool.
And, of course, I felt great.
Yeah, you want people to notice, don't you?
Well, you do, but on the other hand, I felt it was quite important that I didn't tell anyone, because I think as soon as you say you're on a diet, you've got all these lovely people that come up and say, do you want a sweetie?
But your fiancé, which version does he prefer?
Well, I think he said he was, obviously it was for me, you know, when he met me, I was still really overweight, and that is again why I decided that yes, I would get engaged to him, but obviously I think it's been a bonus now.
Ah, he won the jackpot, you know. Didn't he? The truth be known.
Well, well done, Kay. But you're not leaving us, because this is the vital bit for all us tubbies. In just a moment, we're going to be looking at just what Kay used to eat in the bad, bad old days before she shed 9 stone, was it?
No, 8 stone.
8 stone. Well, that's still brilliant. And we're also going to be speaking to an expert on how we can all do it too. That after the break.
Horace and Horatio are hooking all the best rides. Do something, Beefy.
Oh, I'm in the middle of my new Heinz beans and burger bites.
Not now, you're not.
Whoa. Look out!
No artificial colours or preservatives.
What's that? Give me that bag.
We gotta take one each. Okay, now.
We ain't broke the bank.
Nope. But you sure done broke the bank. Get it, boys.
When it comes to the crunch, eat a Smith Square Crisp.
If your hair doesn't have it, your hair's gotta get it, get strong. Get Flex Ability.
Flex conditioner with balsam and protein. Protects against heat. Builds body. Shine. That's Flex conditioner.
Get strong, get Flex Ability.
Flex conditioner, part of the Flex bodybuilding system. From Revlon.
I tell you what, I'm feeling really fat at the moment. Kay's with us. And we're joined also by Dr. Debbie Hastings-Neal, who's a real expert on how we can all slim and do it healthily too. Now, Kay, let's go back to the bad, bad old days then. You got up in the morning, and what did you eat?
Well, it was the kettle went on right away.
Kettle?
Yes, kettle.
You didn't eat the
tea.
Kettle, did you?
No, it all escaped.
Right. I'm going to check that. Okay.
It'd get stuck in my teeth. And it was always into the biscuit barrel.
The biscuit barrel?
Yes.
We got biscuits?
That's the biscuits over there.
The biscuits over there were the first, okay, right. Then what happened?
So then it would usually be 2 or 3 slices of toast, and I didn't have, you know, sort of butter with my toast. I had toast with my butter.
You had toast. It's a huge mountains of toast over there. We all know what toast looks like, don't we?
Yes, with lots of butter.
Lots of butter.
Yes.
Okay. So that, presumably, you were satisfied for a time there, were you?
Yes. Yes.
So what happened then? What, about an hour later, 2 hours later?
Well, if I had to go for petrol on the way to work, there was all those tempting sweets and things.
Absolutely.
You just place them, you know, right beside where you're going to pay.
So you went and got what, sweets at the garages?
Yeah. And crisps of course, they were for sort of mid-morning, but they never usually lasted till then.
Your mid-morning.
Because they were sitting on the seat shouting at me to you.
So now, but of course, now you've got a real hunger up because you're comfort eating, aren't you? You're a bit depressed
yes,
and you're comfort eating.
Because yes, I feel bad for eating so much.
You feel bad for eating, so there's one thing to do, isn't there? Eat more
yes.
at lunchtime. What did you eat for lunchtime, Kay?
Well, you've missed the sort of...
I missed one.
You've missed one.
I can't believe it.
Well,
go on.
It's an accounts department that I work in,
yeah.
and they tend to be a great hand for cakes and things like that. So, of course, somebody would either have been home baking or whatever. So
home baking. I think we've got a baked...
I think that's...
Where are we now?
The donut.
The donut?
I think.
So up came
sure.
the donut, in between the sweets at the petrol station and lunch.
Yes.
Okay. But then you had lunch to think about. This is the big...
The thing is, as well, I'd like to stress, an awful lot of the time I wasn't even hungry. It just seemed to become... a sort of a pattern of food was there, it got hoovered in, and that was
What sort of lunch did you have, Kay?
Well, it's a canteen at work, and it's all sort of things like macaroni cheese or steak pie or whatever. So, of course, I would have that.
We better whiz through because this is getting a horrific catalogue,
Kay. I know, it's terrible.
And then throughout the day after that, roughly what?
Yeah, well, it would maybe be some more crisps or whatever in the afternoon.
Crisps, yeah.
Yeah, and then when I went home, my mum would always have... you know, sort of a couple of courses anyway.
So what we're saying is you became a rather big girl.
Yes.
Yes, all right. Well, let's talk to Dr. Debbie Hastings-Neal. Now, Debbie, that's a fairly horrific tale, isn't it?
It is,
it's comfort
really.
Eating, on the one hand, so it's a psychological thing, isn't it?
Yes.
Kay was a bit depressed, so she's had to keep eating.
Right.
But what were the wrong things she was doing?
Well, all this side can be summed up by saying fat and calories. That's essentially what all this is. Mm. There is some protein. But there's a hell of a lot more fat and calories there.
Now, Kay became a very clever girl, didn't she? Because she
really
then changed diets. How many? I'm told there's about 5,000 calories a day, isn't there, in this? Something like that.
That looks about right. The average woman needs about 2,000 calories a day.
2,000 calories?
There are about 3,000 in excess.
Interesting you say that, because some diets that you read about, and they'll suggest, what, 500 calories a day or even less?
Well, some are suggesting 150 calories, kilo
calories.
Should
we be eating this?
Rubbish. You simply starve yourself. You lose the protein from your body, as I said, and it's most unhealthy. The best way to do it is slowly and sensibly with this.
Right. Now, what have we got here, then? Take us through these foods and what we should all be eating and avoiding, of course, those garage petrol sweets.
Yes. Well, no sweets, first of all. Lots of protein, cottage cheese, fibre in crisp bread and vegetables, fruit, vegetables. Vitamin C, orange, and lots of vegetables. That's before. Beans, good source of protein.
Beans?
Beans.
I thought you were supposed to stay away from those.
Well, they can have undesirable social consequences, but...
Can they? Well, I never knew about that. What else
But we won't
be?
Talk about that. Rice, I think, is this, and tuna.
Rice.
Yes.
Fish, chicken, all excellent.
Do you like this? Do you like that? Do you like all that?
It looks very tasty.
I really had to change... My eating habits. I mean, as you can see there, it's a drastic change. I mean, it's gone from sort of, you know, now it's sort of high fibre, low fat and low sugar.
And no petrol.
And no petrol.
No petrol. Tell you what, folks, this is a really tough job, isn't it? Debbie, Kay, thank you so much. What an example to us all.
Well done.
Richard.
Isn't it strange? I was just about to say Michael Morris gritting his teeth, not because it was the food that he was trying to avoid, but he was trying to convince us that he wasn't really enjoying the company. Right, we move on. We're joined back in the studios here by the authoress, Pat Booth. Pat, hello again. Food we were talking about there. I, as I've mentioned once or twice already, I think I'm beginning to bore people, have started to try and lose a few pounds. Is it difficult?
You don't need to lose
I do,
weight,
but
Richard.
You believe it. I do. Is it difficult leading the sort of life that's available to you when you can purchase and do virtually what you want, when you want, to maintain some sort of discipline?
Well, I'm a Taurian and I simply love food. I mean, I just am a glutton, basically, and I end up becoming Miss Blimp over a period of time and then sort of like reducing myself. I lose half of me. But I do find it easier in America because everybody is geared to health and sort of, and you wear less clothes, you wear far fewer clothes in Palm Beach. So it does show. So you're kind of much more conscious. But I'm really having a holiday here and eating everything. The other thing I find is the food is so much better in England now than it ever was. So that's great. Fabulous.
Why would
My
that
food
be?
Is not much better, but...
You're tired perhaps of the fast food availability in America?
I think so, yes. And it's I just think the restaurants have become really excellent. Very, very good. I've just been to France and actually I've been having better food here than I did in France, and that's a very unusual statement to make.
You've encouraged me. You've spoken at length about British success since you joined us in the studios this morning. Next week here at TVAM, we're launching a new campaign to help youngsters who at this time of the year are sitting anxiously waiting for exam results. Some might do better than they think, others worse. Now, your life has been, I think, a total success. How have you managed that from a situation whereby you had to scrap and battle a bit during your youth?
Very much so, yes. I came from a very sort of poor background, from the East End, as you say, which was a kind of very rough environment too. I think I was very fortunate because, unlike a lot of people here, I saw education to be a privilege. I didn't see it as something you had to do at your peril. I left a school which didn't educate us awfully well, but I was then very fortunate. I was determined to put myself through Pitman's College because I remember my mum always saying to me, listen, if modelling doesn't work out for you, you can always become a secretary, which luckily I didn't have to do, but I certainly... you see, that's what I think is very healthy about the American mentality, again. The fact that kids do put themselves through college. They do feel that education is something that they need, they've got to work at. Education is a very, very unpleasant process, but we've all got to go through it. And I absolutely think that Kenneth Baker was right when he said that people have got to go back almost to their times tables. They've got to discipline themselves into learning those things before they can carry on and do other things. So I think we've got to see education as tough, but at the same time, it's something we've simply got to go through.
Mm. Welcome back.
Oh, yes.
Hello, dear.
Yes.
You clearly enjoyed yourself over there.
Well, no, a highly educational item, that one, wasn't it? What we should be eating and what we shouldn't be eating.
But it is.
Of course, if you go to the Beverly Hills Hotel, which, of course, you know well, you eat yourself stupid, don't you, Pat?
It's wondrous. It's wondrous. And that swimming pool?
That swimming pool.
I mean, isn't that the best thing in the world?
I like to read a book about that.
I've just written one.
Well, what an uncanny thing. What an unbelievable... You know, Orson
called
Welles.
Beverly Hills. It comes out next April.
You know, Orson Welles occupied the same chair for years at that hotel.
I sat on his lap.
Really?
Most of those days.
It's one way to slim, isn't
That's
it?
That's a story we haven't got time to go into, unfortunately. Yeah. Pat Booth, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, I think we
understand the message, too. Success 88, just to bang the drum once or twice more. Important week next week here at TVAM. If you've got any doubts about your future, join us at some stage and I'm sure that we'll be able to help you out.
Yeah, and despite everything, Muesli Mallet, Timmy Mallet, Seamus O'Mallet, they've all been successes despite everything. You'll see why after this break.
Pat, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Dizzy, dizzy dinosaur. He knocks you out as he moves about.
Dizzy, dizzy dinosaur.
He's real nice. Till you roll the dice.
Dizzy, dizzy dinosaur.
He's a silly beast, to say the least.
Dizzy, dizzy dinosaur.
Turns and spins till someone wins. Dizzy, dizzy dinosaur from MB.
Big dumb.
The bottle's green, but don't adjust your set. It's new Domestos Fresh for the directable jet. It kills germs dead, and it clings real well. What's so new? It's got a fresh smell. Big dumb. So when cleaning your toilet, just follow your nose and choose one of the bathroom's big heroes. Because remember, folks, whether green or blue, there's no meaner germ killer in your loo. Big Dom. Big Bad Dom.
Sprinter from Majorette. From Majorette. Sprinter from Majorette.
Here, Church of Tricks is throwing 10 pence.
Remember, loose talk costs newsagents. Chewits, two extra pieces, free.
Okay.
Da-da-da. Guten Tag, meine Vaterwakers. Jungfrau Day, Jungfrau Day. Hello. What do you think of the utterly brilliant hat? Well, I thought you might like this, so I thought I'd wear this today. This is my very own mountain, which I'm wearing today. And in fact, today I'm going to show you, wide awakers, how you can make your whack face of the Eiger. Also, a little bit later on coming up this morning, we have the world-famous Eiger, where we'll be going up on a special train trip through the world-famous Eiger, up its ugly north face. There's also more exciting adventures, of course, with Galaxy High School. We'll show you how to make your own skis and go skiing in your living room as well. But first of all, a nice chirpy hello from Magic, who, as you can hear, is in a good mood today. Hello, Magic. Hello. He's in a very good mood. He's going to show you today how to do a very daring climb up the north face of his cage. Go, Magic. That's it. There he goes. He did it. Amazing. For the first time ever, Wide Awakers, Magic did what he was supposed to do. I can't believe it. And here's how you pull the whack face of the Eiger. Are you ready? You go, and that's it. Here we go with some pictures and things which have been sent in for Magic. First of all, a little bucket in spade. Very nice. This is from Rachel Nash, who's 10 years old and lives in Buxton. So you can go and dig your own whacker a one moat here, Magic. So there you go with your bucket and spade there. Pair of skis have been sent here with a pair of boots on the top. These are from Worsley, from Joanne and Alison, who live in Worsley, and they've made these skis for you. That's nice. Over here is another pair of skis with little bits on. You made them out of lollipop sticks. Well done, Jamie Clancy of Hook. So that's good. Those are for you. Now, pictures here. Come on, girls, going to need you to help me pin these up. Nicholas Siner is 9 years old, lives in Haydock in Merseyside. And this is William Tell firing the bow and arrow at the cuckoo clock on top of his dad's head. Dad, I think it should be an apple. There we go. That goes up over there on that board over here. Cuckoo clock here with Timmy's house inside. And you open it up and there's somebody who looks completely and utterly brilliant inside with mallets there. And here is the Eiger, in fact, from Daryl Moss, who's 12 years old, lives in Bury St. Edmunds. There's the Eiger going, wackaday, wackaday, wackaday. Marvellous. What's this here? This is from Matthew and Richard Pickering from Lincoln. And as you can see, this is a picture of us in Switzerland with Magic and the mallet. Watch out for the wild Swiss rolls. There we go. Put that one up over here as well. All right, Wide Awakers, let's play the first round of this morning's game of... Hey, come on, boys, bring your stools in. Right, I'm going to explain a little bit later on, by the way, because what you have to be wearing tomorrow on dress-up day, and it's a very, very exciting load of things to be wearing tomorrow. Right, the two boys who are taking part today are...
Sam.
Right. Shallot. Sam Shallot. A shallot. Here he is, a vegetable. Marvellous. Brilliant. OK, Sam, where are you going for your holiday?
Nowhere.
Nowhere at all. Great place to go. We want a postcard from nowhere. And against Sam, we have...
Paul Jones.
Where are you from?
Clues in North Wales.
Right, OK, where are you going for your holiday?
Garden Shed.
The Garden Shed, a great place to go. OK, so it's Paul and Sam, one of word association game. When you must pause, hesitate, repeat a word or say a word I don't like, otherwise you get rushing out like this. All that is all those things you do, these things you go through, get a chance to win the other box. Look at each other and pull the wet face of the Eiger. Lovely, look at them and pull the wet face of the Eiger. And what do you do at home? Thank you, well done. Here we go with the first word, which is panda.
Frog. Animal.
Hang on a second, just a panda and a frog. That's completely nonsense. Right, garden.
Shed.
Yes.
Grass.
Yes.
Flowers.
Pond.
Grass.
Yellow.
Green.
Purple.
Pink.
Yellow.
No! Right, we've got reed.
Oboe.
Oh, that's good.
Don't know.
Right, brolly. Time's up. You got one. You got two or three or whatever it was. And I don't know, and I like the don't know. Right, here we go with the whack an Eiger, which is going on your nose. Now, you're going to do an impersonation of your nose doing the whack face of the Eiger. Go. Lovely. That's brilliantly done. And you're back for the final. OK, hold that. This is a very exciting picture here, Wide Awakers. From a remote from California. Now this, as you can see, is the little work moat being built here by Bethany Wobbington, who's on holiday in America. And in fact is a remote from California. So let's watch out today for the wonderful whack snaps of wonderful remotes all over the wonderful world. And we want to know, Wide Awakers, where is the remotest remote being made? So let us know, send them in, and you can see them on whack snaps like now.
Your love, and you can shake your love. I'm under a fair again.
here comes the first wacky hat on the wacky hat parade today, and it's fallen off. Hang on, stay still, Joanne. Put it on again, put it on, put it on. Little bit of a hiccup here as the first hat goes on, and as you can see, it is a marvellous William Tell hat, an arrow through the apple, which has fallen right off your head. I love it. Hat number two here is an Alpenhorn hat. This is lovely. Do us a nice little twirl here, will you please? A nice twirl. That's lovely. Good. There we go. And there's the Alpenhorn going blare out of the side of it. Marvellously done. Hat number three is here, and this one is being paraded by an Eiger head. Okay, and this is the cuckoo clock. And can you just bend down so we can see the top of it? There we go. That's it. There's an apple, I think, as well. And it looks like they've got the wrong time, but it's been made out of apples and lovely and mallets and stuff. It's a brilliant hat. Hat number four is here. I like the little woo. Bend down so we can see what's on the top of it. Bend down a little bit so we can see. There we go, Paul. That is, it looks like a Timmy head on the top of it. Good little wacky hats, these wide awakers. And of course, what you have to do is to make your own wacky hat and send them in to Wacky Hats, Wackaday, TVAM, PO Box 200, London, NW1, 8CQ. Time for round two now. Here we go. Up you get, onto your stools, girls. And, this is really nice. You made this, didn't you? Put it on and model it for us. Okay. I'll hold on to your Alpenhorn. Put this on. Look at this hat here, Wide Awakers. Shove it on your head. And this is a magic hat for Magic's birthday, which, of course, is next year. He's very excited about that. I know, Magic, you can eat the hat later, OK? And, of course, with his birthday, we're going to have the cage. Shh, don't tell anybody, OK? I'll put this over here. Magic, you can eat it now. Here we go. Mallet's mallet. Are we ready? It's a word association game where you must suppose it has to say, otherwise you get bashing the head like this or like this. And one of the things you suppose you guys find yes, and they win the Apple Million Prize. Look at each other. Pull the north face of the Eiger. Lovely. Pull the north face of the Eiger at them. And the white face of the Eiger back again. Here we go. Oh, very nice. Good. Okay, here's the first word, and it is carpet. What? Oh, too slow. Much too slow. Right, rabbit.
Ears.
Ears, yes.
Animal.
Yep.
Nose.
Nose.
Ears.
No, she just said ears. Right, fish and chip shop.
Eat.
Eat, yep.
Fish
Hello.
Cake.
What did you say?
Fish cake.
Fish cake, yeah, we'll accept that.
Nice.
Nice. No, don't like nice, not having that. Okay. Head. Time's up already. How many did you get? One. Okay, how many did you get?
Two.
You got two, so I'm sorry to say, Joanne, you got the plaster. Where's it going? Oh, on the elbow. No, I have this elbow. I like this elbow. Here we go. I want your elbow now to do an impersonation of a whacker ski. And we'll see you back for the final bit later, Vicky, OK? Don't look so nervous. Don't look so worried. It'll be dead easy, honestly. Time to catch up now on the exciting adventures going on in the Intergalactic Galaxy High School. And the question is, of course, will Amy and Doyle be successful in their attempt to get Milo's job back at the Exploding Pizza Parlor? Or will the ball of fluff be fluffy? Well, watch your space, as we say. Galaxy High!
Galaxy High! Galaxy High!
Milo may need our help, and where are we?
Help? What do you mean?
Milo was fired last night, and nobody's seen him since.
Fired? That's terrible. We gotta do something. We gotta find him.
That's the Galaxy High spirit. We'll start at the Galleria. Let's go! Milo!
Milo! Milo! Milo!
Milo! Any luck, Amy?
Amy, Doyle, come quick. I think I found Milo.
Milo!
Hey, come on!
Oh,
whoo!
Rocking high school
kids! Down now! Remember your manners. Why, there's people ahead of you.
What have you done with Milo?
You've turned him into some kind of a zombie or something.
Release him this instant, or I shall be forced to call the authorities.
And you'll be working with the man working on the chain gang.
I doubt that, my young friends. You see, Milo signed a contract.
I hereby agree to serve the firm of A. Gatori for a period of not less than 25 years in the position of
Oh, this print's so small I can hardly read it.
Allow me, Amy.
Living mannequin.
Well, it's all perfectly legal, as you can see. Now, I have some customers.
Legal or not, I'm taking Milo out of here. And don't try to stop me.
Youthful high spirit.
Ow! Oh, my. Energy bars.
You can't get away with this. Milo would never sign a contract like that willingly. We'll get a lawyer.
Be my guest. I'm sure you'll explain to him how all of you snubbed the poor lad, driving him to this decision.
What do you mean?
Why, Milo told me about you so-called friends, how you wouldn't talk to him because of a few little mistakes. When I offered him the post, he was rather grateful. I guess he felt that without friends, he was better off as a mannequin. Tragic, really.
Milo, Milo. Milo, we done you so wrong.
I'm sure you all feel terrible, but don't blame yourselves too much. It was his choice. Do feel free to come by and see him anytime. Well, goodbye now.
Gosh, I never thought Milo would do something like this.
Poor Milo. We drove him into becoming a dummy.
Milo wouldn't do this, no matter how bad he felt. Milo was no quitter.
You're right, Amy. That lizard was lying to us. I'll bet he tricked Milo into signing that contract.
He can't do that to my pal, Milo. I'll plasmarize him.
Wait. Gatori's clever. And to help Milo, we have to be too. Let's go.
Where to?
Professor Eisenstein, Dimbo.
Yeah. This mannequin or dummy state, as we scientists know it, can be reversed if it is caught within 24 hours. Otherwise, it will last anywhere from 20 to 25 years. Gives you a really good rest, though. However, there is a chemical reanimation formula that will do the trick. I just don't happen to know what that is. Well, what the heck? We try a few. Bit too much of their overstrapping gazelle gestricht. You know what I mean?
No, I don't know what you mean. I love it. Too much of the hair. And I do like this singing ball of cotton wool, Wide Awakers. Please, let's have some singing balls of cotton wool sent in as soon as possible. Now, listen, more details just coming in on that heavy meteorite storm in the northwest tip of Neptune's third moon. Apparently, the sun is coming out on Neptune, and all the 12-legged green frong thingy bob aliens are going for a swim in the ammonia, so it'll be marvellous. They'll thoroughly enjoy themselves. Weather forecast now for the rest of the galaxy. Well, as you can see, temperatures are roughly temperatures. All for Essies today, so Stevens and Sarahs, hello to you. What we got in Sydney? 26 degrees, fair and sunny down under in their winter. In Singapore, it's 32 and rainy. Blah. Right, in Seoul, where they're going to have the Olympic Games, it's, of course, Olympic weather there, at 31 degrees and a little bit cloudy. Over now to Pyong, South America, and down to Santiago, the Semolina. Yes, 14 degrees there, very chilly in Chile. And up to San Francisco, where it's 23 degrees. It should be warmer over there, actually. Not too good. And in Switzerland today, here we go, in Switzerland on the Jungfraubahn, which is where we're going later on, by the way, Wide Awakers. It is 24 degrees today. Natalie Jones, thank you for your card from you and your mum. Now, the UK's weather. Let's have a look over here and see what we have. Well, very Scottish weather in Scotland today, Wide Awakers. This is from Helen Dunkeld, who says she caught a pet crab and called it Timmy, which is a good name, and that goes up over there. We've got about 19 degrees in Scotland today, and it might be a little bit cloudy. Okay, call the clouds whack-a-cloud or whatever. Kylie is from Melbourne in Australia, and she's not on Neighbours. She sent in a card from Sudbury to say, what's the weather like in Sudbury? Well, it'll be very sudsy in Sudbury today, and very neighbourly as well for Kylie. Lovely. That goes up over there, and about 23 degrees. Well, don't put it in an island, you nit. Swanage, here we go. We're swanning around in Swanage at the moment, and there aren't any swans there. What will the weather be like? Well, it'll be very swanny in Swanage today. Laurie and Lisa Mawson, 23 degrees over there. Kettering, what will it be like in Kettering? Well, loads of ringing in Kettering. Matthew Jackson says we're having a really wonderfully wacky holiday in Wetterwing. Lovely. Good. And the weather there will be about 20 degrees today. And that's over in the North Sea. Kettering's obviously moved. So keep those cards coming in, Wide Awakers. Send them to Magic, because he likes to eat the cards. And you send it to Magic at Wacaday, TV AM, PO Box 200, London, NW1, 8TQ. And right now, it's time for this. Now, are you sitting comfortably, Magic? Good, you are. In that case, I'll begin. Here we go with our hero of the day today. And today's utterly brilliant and utterly amazing heroic hero of the day today has been sent in by Elaine, who's 6 years old and she lives in Cramlington in Northumberland. And she wants to nominate a wok as her hero of the day today. One very hot sort of wackaday, Elaine was busy in her wacker pool playing with her yellow rubber ducks. Wacker quack, wacker quack, they were going. And all of a sudden, a great big wacker wasp, thinking that the wacker quacking ducks were in fact flowers, dive bombs straight into the wacker pool. Wacker splash, wacker dive, wacker gurgle, wacker ugh, it went. Desperately, the wasp struggled for some moments doing the wasp paddle, but all to no avail as it slowly began to wacker sink to the wacker bottom. Wacker glug, it went. And then, miraculously, a wacker wok, which had been preparing itself for the evening barbecue, all of a sudden spotted the plight of the unfortunate wasp. And with absolutely no thought for its own personal cooking oil, it leapt from its position on the hot bricks and dived into the pool. Wacker sizzle, wacker splash it went. And within seconds, it had swept the stricken wasp out of the pool and delivered it safely onto the grass to dry again, which is a very, very brave, what a wok. Amazing wackaday here. What a wally wasp as well for forgetting its wetsuit. And of course, if you know of a heroic thingy, send us in your hero of the day to Hero of the Paddling Pool. Wackaday, tea is very damp, land in the water, not one person ate the barbecue. TQ. Okay? Right, now then, shortly we'll have the Manic Minute. I'll also be starting my ascent of the beautiful Jungfrau by train in Switzerland, and we'll have the final of Mallet's Mallet and some more chirps and magic as well. So if you're together, everybody all together, go on. Pull the whack face of the Eiger.
Nosy bears' noses are fun, it is true. Squeeze nosy bears' tummies, they'll share the fun with you. When things go weird in your neighborhood, who'll sort it out? Not me, man. Adventure Comics, that'll spook you good. What they all about?
Ghostbusters!
I could get to like these spooks, man.
There's a real Ghostbusters adventure comic in special packs of
Here's a new exciting toy. It's made by Kittycraft. Our kitty vac might look like mum's, but it's only for a laugh. It washes down, it brushes up, it gets things clean and bright. And when the work is finished, well, just pack up for the night. Hey! Kittycraft!
Bedbugs!
Bedbugs! Bedbugs is the frantic game where everyone picks a colour, then scrambles to catch the most bugs. Bedbugs from MB. It'll drive you buggy.
Yes! 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 Yes!
Don't say yes.
Say yes!
Don't miss the Lego Festival. There's lots of games and competitions with star prizes and a flight to the Legoland Park in Denmark. And there's lots of fun for everyone at a toy shop near you.
Here come the hungry, hungry hippos. Whoever's hippo gets the most marbles wins the game. Hungry, hungry hippos from MB.
Ear, chew extra Chewits and still only 10p.
Shh. Chewits, 2 pieces free.
Every lovable, brushable brush love has its own brushy tail, its own sweet-smelling powder puff paw, and its own brush love mirror. The lovable, brushable brush loves from Matchbox.
Smith's Salt and Shake crisps now come in grilled bacon flavour.
And cheese and onion flavour.
All you do is add the salt.
Battle Beasts.
Rub their battle badges to reveal their secret strengths. There's a whole army to collect.
Battle Beasts. Battle till the battle's won.
It's
It is Wackaday, Wide Awakers. Okay. Now then, shortly, I'll be showing you how you can make your very own set of skis so you can go skiing in the living room. And also, a little bit later on, I'll tell you exactly what you have to wear for tomorrow's dressing update. It's very exciting because I'm going to show you how to make a mountain. Here we go. On to the board now. Why did the mushroom have a lot of parties? Because he was a fun guy. Thank you to Alexandra Innit. Great name, Innit. Good it is, and I like it too, and I like your hat. Right, here we go with the Manic Minute. Let's find out who's on the phone today. Hello.
Hello.
Who are you?
Hey, Jonathan.
What did you say your name was?
Jonathan.
Jonathan. Where are you calling from, Jonathan?
Manchester.
And where are you going for your holidays?
Pardon?
Where are you going for your holes?
I've already been to Tenerife in Wales.
Very nice. Good, good. Can you say that long name in Wales?
No.
Neither can I. I'm sure somebody must be able to. It's very difficult. Let's fill in the gaps over here. You've got to find out, is it the name of a band, or is it the name of a singer, or is it the name of a song, OK?
Yeah, OK.
OK, you've got 60 seconds to work it out to win the wacky watch. Are you ready? On your marks, get set, go!
A for apple.
Yes, there is an A.
E for egg.
No E.
I for igloo.
Yes, there is an I.
O for orange.
No O.
U for umbrella.
No U.
S for sausage.
Yes, there is an S. You're going to need some consonants now.
N for naughty.
What do you say?
N for naughty.
No N. Try the other one.
M for mother.
Good one.
Me for Paris.
Yes, it is. Well done. That's good. You did that very quickly too, which means, of course, you have won the utterly brilliant wacky watch. Which arm is it going on, Jonathan?
Right arm.
On your right arm. There it is. It's a great strap. It's a great watch. It'll be for you. And here's the song from Misha Paris now, and it's called Like Dreamers Do. No, it's not. It's called... What's it called?
Like Dreamers Do.
That's it. It is called Like Dreamers Do. I'm a little knit. Here it is now. Paris, like dreamers do, on the Manic Minute this morning. So well done, Jonathan. And if you want to take part, here's the address. It's Manic Minute, Wackaday, TVAM, PO Box 200, London, NW1 HEQ, with your phone number. Very important to put your phone number down, otherwise we can't phone you up, can we? Right, it's time for the further adventures of Tyrion and his trips on the Grand Tour in Switzerland. And today, one of the most amazing train rides in the world. The morning train to the Jungfrau Joch station. This is no ordinary journey because Wide Awakers, it takes us from warm summer meadows right up to a freezing glacier 12,000 feet up. It's amazing. Here we go. Good morning, Wide Awakers. Today we're going to the top of one of the tallest mountains in Europe. It's over 11,000 feet high and I've got everything I need. Wax sack on my back, my ice pick, my altitude sickness tablets and a train ticket. Because this is one of the most extraordinary train rides in the world. A train which goes all the way to the top of a mountain. Halfway up Wide Awakers, we changed trains. This is the rush hour train. It's like catching a tube. Up a mountain? Even at this time of year, there's still snow right up on the very top of the mountains. And in fact, most of that snow will stay there all year round because it's so high. All the houses in Switzerland have these really nice steep roofs. This is so that in the winter you can have really good ski jumps right off the top. Meow! Blop! Hey, look at that!
bag of haystacks. And that is our final destination. That little pinprick right on the very top. Amazing railway. It was built in 1890. That's when it was started, and it actually works quite differently to a normal railway line because, as well as the rails, it's got this. This is the cog which makes sure the train doesn't go scootling backwards. And how does it get to the top of the mountain? Inside. I guess they keep very careful control of the whole lot here, right away, because we come round this corner, we go into a tunnel, and we disappear inside the Jungfrau Mountain. Amazing! And here it comes, the actual start of the tunnel. Here we go into the pitch blackness. At 9,500 feet, they let us out for a quick look at the view and a breath of fresh air. The highest post office in Europe. 11,500 feet above sea level, and a good place to post the cards of magic. Are you ready? And this is it. It's arrived, Wide Awakers, with a remote, which has been dug in the middle of the snow on top of the Jungfrau Mountain. It says on the other side, Magic, I'll read it to you. It says, Dear Magic, it's utterly magic here on top of this mountain. You wouldn't like to fly here, but you could always catch the train. Love, Timmy. There you go. And that we'll go there, Magic, and that's for you. Now, tomorrow, Wide Awakers, we'll be actually going down the mountain onto the glacier right at the very top. It's amazing. But now I'm going to show you how you can make your own skis if you'd like to ski down a mountain or ski across your own living room. Need a couple of volunteers here, so let's have the two volunteers over. Actually, first of all, I'll show you how to make the Alpenhorn, because this is the important thing to do. When you go to Switzerland, you have to make a lot of noise. This is the Alpenhorn. Can you blow it for us, Sam? Here we go. What a great wacky noise there, Wide Awakers. That's a brilliant... How do you make it? Well, of course, you're going to need an awful lot of these. The famous kitchen roll holders and loo roll holders. Come on, give us a hand down here. I'll show you what you do. You get the sellotape like this. Come on, Danny, come. Put these together for me. And hold this. And let's stick the next end on. That's it. And you stick these together like this, as many as you can. And then you paint it. And at the end, you have an Alpenhorn the length of this. Let's blow it for us again, will you? One, two, three. Marvellous. So that's the Alpenhorn. Now, how do you make the skis to go with the Alpenhorn? Well, very exciting here. You get a very long tube. And then you cut it in half. It's important to cut the tube in half. And then you get it rounded like this. Can you see? You understand, Wide Awakers? Good. I need your feet. Here you go. Put your feet down here. And one foot on each ski. As you can see, what we've done is we've cut the tube in half and then cut some colour at the end, some coloured card like that. You're going to need some quite strong tape here to go over your foot. OK, lift this foot up. That's it. OK, we're going to... OK. Like that. And then on the other foot as well. Lift it up. Stick this on like this. It's a bit like the clogs we made the other week, but even wackier. Now, here are your ski poles, and now you can ski right across the living room. Off you go. Come on. Fantastically made, Wide Awakers, and those are what you have to make all day today, because tomorrow it's very important that you wear skis, an apple for William Tell, a Swiss roll, and a cowbell as well. That's our dressing up day tomorrow. Right. Okay. Time for the final. Here we go. Two finalists, bring your stools in and in your cup. What a mess we're making. Don't forget, apple on your head for William Tell. Bring your stools in. The two finalists, that's it. Apple on your head for William Tell tomorrow, a cowbell, pair of skis, and a Swiss roll.
Hold on, I want that. there first.
No, you're not. You were out the first round. Here we go. You must have another go. Right, our two finalists, who have we got? Paul and... and Victoria, right, okay. Mallet. A word association game where you mustn't cross the hesitate or repeat a word or say a word I don't know, like otherwise you get matched. I like this or like this one with the most bruises loses. Okay, hang on. Hang on, let's try it again. That's more like it. One with the most bruises loses, one with the least bruises gets the utterly brilliant prize. So look at each other and go blah.
Yeah.
Look at them and go blah.
Yeah.
What do you say at home? Yeah. Thank you. Here we go. The first word is cabinet.
Cupboard.
What? Cupboard, yes.
Wardrobe.
Yeah.
Drawers. Desk.
Okay, snowball.
Snow.
Yeah. Too slow for you. Okay, diamond.
Round.
What?
Round.
Round? No, I'm not going to have that. Okay, we'll have the weather.
Cold. Hot. Freezing.
How many did you get?
One.
How many did you get?
I
think you got two. So the plaster's going on you. Where are you going to have the plaster?
On my foot.
On the foot. Here we go. Right. Down there. Wiggle your foot up and down like a whack of ski. And you've got the prizes. Here we go. Here's your wax act and your hits 8LP, which goes like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Lovely. And if you want to play Mallet's Mallet, I want to hear from you as soon as possible. Write in and tell.
Tortoise. I mean... do you give it three meals a day? Do you let it wander around the garden? Can you keep it indoors?
It very much depends on how you're keeping it. If you've got it in a large garden, then it'll probably forage around and find an awful lot of food for itself anyway. And, and those people are feeding lettuce. The animal probably gets far more nutrition from the garden than it does from the lettuce.
But you don't put food out on a plate for it, do you?
Oh, yes, yes.
You do?
It's a good thing to do that. And also some vitamin supplementation, because where these tortoises come from, they eat a vast... variety of foods, particularly vegetation, of course.
Right.
And for us to try and copy that is virtually impossible. So some sort of vitamin powder sprinkled on the food,
right.
Such things as tomato, a variety of green stuff, some fruit, particularly in the autumn, are all good things.
They, I have to say, in fairness, they don't seem to give a lot back, tortoises. I mean, they're just there and they wobble around a bit.
Yeah, well, tortoises are reptiles, and reptiles are not very high up in the scheme of things. They are one of the lower vertebrates.
Yes.
They're not particularly intelligent animals, and you can't truthfully form an emotional link with a tortoise. I know a lot of people would claim that you can.
Yes.
But
That's probably the understatement of the 20th century. You can't form an emotional relationship with the
tortoise.
Not
everybody would agree with you, though.
Really? Now, I know that there's one thing that you're very strong on, Don, and that is about how one should treat a tortoise, for hibernation.
Yes, well, tortoises do hibernate in the wild, but, of course, they come from a much more southerly latitude, so they don't hibernate for the length of time that we expect them to hibernate. Now, we tend to put our tortoises in a box, in a shed or somewhere,
yeah,
and expect them to stay there for 5 or 6 months and have picked up enough bodily reserves during the summer to keep them going. That's an awful long time for them to have to survive. Not only have they got a longer winter to survive, they've also got a shorter summer in which to build up those bodily reserves. So you have to acclimatise the tortoise very gradually to it.
Yeah.
I would really ideally like to see tortoises in their first winter in this country have a much shorter hibernation period than we normally expect them
and
to.
And in a cooler
and
place.
Keep them warm for a while until they would normally be ready to go down, and then bring them down to it very gradually.
Down to the cooler atmosphere,
yes,
gradually.
But there are several points to remember on hibernation which a lot of people really aren't clear on. One is the fact that tortoises mustn't hibernate with a full gut.
Right.
Because if they're cooled down with food in the stomach,
of course,
that the digestive system slows down because they're cooler. The food will rot and cause peritonitis and other problems.
Don, I have to stop you there. In any event, I know that we have in our fact sheet on tortoises a lot of the things that you were just on the point of saying. Bruce, thank you very much indeed for being with us, Bruce Hogan. And Don Reid, of course, is going to come back to us later on from the Cotswold Wildlife Park. If you want the fact sheet on the care of tortoises, write to us, sending a stamped, addressed envelope. Write to us to Wincy's Lovesick Tortoises. There it is. Wincy's Lovesick Tortoises. Good morning, Britain. TVAM, Camden Lock, London, NW1, 8TQ.
Dice, made an award-winning documentary.
Saturday evening.